Well, good morning. Good to see everybody this morning. Hey, if you have your Bibles or your device, whatever you use to read God's Word, go ahead and take it out. Turn to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 6 is where we're continuing our series. We kind of looked at Genesis chapter 6, the first seven verses last week, kind of the beginning of the Noah account. If you're familiar with the Noah's Ark account in Genesis, we're going to finish that up today. But as you're looking for that, by the way, Genesis is the very first book in the Bible. So if you're not really familiar with where things are, just kind of open it up in the front. You're going to be really close to it. But as we think about Noah, how many of you have ever gone on a road trip with your family and a family pet? What was that experience like? Right? Crazy. Last summer, Becky and I took the boys and we went out to New Mexico. It was like a 12-hour ride and we decided we were going to take our dog with us, which he'd never really gone on a trip like that. And it was interesting. Let's just put it that way. Interesting for sure. So I'm just kind of thinking this week, I'm like, okay, I'm Noah. I have my wife, I have my sons, their wives, a few pets, and we're in a boat for a really, really long time. And so some of the things that maybe could have been heard on the ark, top 10 things that could have been heard on the ark. Number 10, hey, there are more than two flies in here, right? You can definitely see that happening, right? Number 9, I finally get a boat, now I gotta take the whole family with me. Just want to go out in the boat. Yeah, see, right over here, he's like, I got a boat, got to take the whole family out. Number 8, wasn't someone supposed to put two shovels on board? That would be helpful, for sure. Number 7, quick, clean up on level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, right? A lot going on there. Number 6, okay, who's the wise guy who brought the mosquitoes on board? I'm pretty sure if I would have been Noah, I'd have been like, look, I know we're supposed to bring two of everything, but let's just skip this one, right? Just leave the mosquitoes. They don't benefit anything. Number 5, don't make me pull this ark over and come back there. Number 4, no ham. You cannot eat the pig. Number 3, whatever you do, do not pull this plug out right here. Number 2, nice kitty. And number 1, are we there yet? Right? You can imagine, like, if you're in a boat with these people for that long and these animals, these might have been some of the things that have been said. And a lot of times we think about this account of Noah in the Bible, we think of a kid's story. I have a picture up here. This is probably what some of you think about when you think about Noah's Ark. It's really cute. There's some water and some waves and a little boat with all the cute animals with their heads sticking out. And Noah's kind of become this children's story. And this is the way we think about it. But when you really look at the passage and study the story, it isn't a kid's story because it's a story about God destroying the earth because of sin. And at the same time, I think we're going to see today, not only does God destroy the earth because of sin, but we also see this unimaginable grace and mercy that God ultimately, in this account, I believe, is pointing us to the cross of Jesus Christ. So some of the things that we see as we just study this, and if you were with us last week, you heard a few of these, but I just want to catch us all up. The first thing is the human heart is very wicked. The human heart is very wicked. Matter of fact, sin has a 100% infection rate. Like, we all have it. Let me just ask you, and this is not political. I know you can't even say this word without sounding political. How many of you have had COVID? Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you tried not to get COVID when it first came out? Right? So almost everybody in here has COVID. I think I've had it like 18 times. I think I had it like 2 weeks ago. It just seems like all the time. We've all had it. Probably everybody in here did something of some sort to try not to have it, and we still were all infected. Sin has a 100% infection rate. Matter of fact, one of the fundamental theologies of Christianity, things that we believe, is that every single person is born sinful. You had Adam and Eve in the beginning. They weren't born. They were created. They sinned, and then through Cain, the very first natural birth, first person born with a sin nature. The Bible's very clear about human depravity. Psalm chapter 51 and verse 5 says, surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time when my mother conceived me. Like, not just when I came out into the sunlight, before I was even birthed, I was sinful because we're born with a sin nature. Now, I don't know if you've ever had a conversation with a universalist, and maybe you didn't know you were having a conversation with a universalist, but a universalist is someone who believes that we're all good and we're all kind of on the same path. And if you do your good and I do my good, we'll all end up in the same place. And it's going to work out for everybody. The problem with that is sin. If you ever had a conversation with a universalist, they'll tell you like the difference between me and you Christians is you believe everybody starts off bad, and I believe that everybody starts off good. And that sounds nice, and it's sweet that people would think that. And I'm not saying that lost people can't do good things, but ultimately our hearts are evil. And if you've ever had a conversation with a universalist and they said everybody starts off good, just ask them this question. Do you not have kids? Like, it's amazing. I didn't have to teach Caleb how to ball up his fist and hit his brother. You know, it's like, you know, do it like this. Make sure you step into it, right? You really want to get something behind it. I didn't have to teach him that. It just came out natural. You know what else I didn't have to teach him to say? Mine. It's like, mom, mine. I don't know. Maybe it's the M's or something like that. It just comes out naturally because we're born with this sin nature. We don't have to teach kids how to sin, but we do have to teach our kids how to be good, right? We show them the good things. And so what's happened on the earth as you think about that, Adam and Eve sinned. The sin spread to their kids and their kids' kids and their kids' kids and their kids' kids and their kids' kids, and eventually gets to Noah. In Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5, we pick up, it says, "The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time." Like, I love the description. There's nothing in the Bible that's there by accident. They could have just said, well, people were kind of bad. But it doesn't say that. Every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. I don't know if you remember last week when we were reading the first part of this passage. It said, God said that how long will I contend with mankind? Their years will now only be 120. Basically, up to this point, you had people living 700, 800, 900 years. And God's like, no, that's it. Only 120 years. That's the maximum I'm going to let them live. Have you ever wondered why that is? Like, why did God all of a sudden be like, you know, it's not good to be 850 years old. We're going to limit it to 120. Let me ask you this question. What kind of evil could Hitler have done unchecked if he lived to be 900 years old? I think it would have been pretty bad. You think about the small window that he had an opportunity to just unleash his evil on the earth and the circumstance, millions upon millions murdered. Think about Stalin. What if he was 800, 900 years old, evil left unchecked? He killed millions and millions of people. What if we had 800 years, 900 years to perfect our evil? Like, if you're a plumber and you lived 800 years, you would become a really, really, really good plumber. Like, you would perfect the craft of plumbing. So God looked at humanity and creation. He said, every inclination of their mind is evil all the time. They're murdering each other. They're killing each other. If God hadn't stepped in and limited our lifespan to 120 years, guess what? We'd have destroyed each other. Every inclination of our mind and thought was evil all the time. The human heart is wicked. Second thing we see is that God's patience does come to an end. Like, God is patient. He desires that none should perish, that all should come to faith in Jesus Christ. But his patience does come to an end. God is loving, and that's what we like to hear about God. God is loving and God is love. But we learned last week that God is also just. That there has to be payment for sin because God is a just God. And as you think about that, you know, sometimes we think about Old Testament God, New Testament God. God's been consistent. God has always been just. There had to be justice for sin in the Old Testament. There was justice for sin in the New Testament, and it's called the cross. There has to be payment for sin. In Exodus chapter 34 and verse 6, Moses, who also wrote Genesis, is talking about this. He says, "The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, 'The Lord, a God who is merciful and gracious and slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but who will by no means clear the iniquity.'" Right? That means that God can't just overlook sin. He couldn't look down on sin here in this Noah account where our thoughts are evil all the time and just go, you know what? I'm just going to let him slide. Because God's a holy God. God's standard is holiness. It's perfection, and we fall short of that. That sin infects 100% of the time. And so God is just. There has to be payment for sin. And so we pick up in verse 7 of Genesis chapter 6, the Lord said, I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race I've created, with them the animals, the birds, the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I made them. I know that Matt pointed out last week that really the translation of that word regret, sometimes in English we see regret and we think, oh, God made a mistake. But that's not the meaning of that word. In the Hebrew, literally it says, and God sighed. He sighed that he had created mankind, and this was where our hearts and minds went, to evil thoughts all the time. Now, if you're familiar with the Noah account, all of mankind, evil thoughts all the time. Noah, we're going to see in just a second, found grace in the eyes of God, though he wasn't perfect by any means. So God comes to Noah and he says, listen, I'm going to wipe out my creation because sinfulness all the time. I'm going to start over basically with you, and gave him instructions. He said, I want you to build a boat. Now, that might not sound like that big a deal, but Noah lived in the desert. And for 1,600 years, it hadn't rained. So you can imagine, like, Noah's like, God, are you really talking to me right now? Is this like indigestion from the fajitas I ate last night? Because we live in a desert and it has never rained before. I don't even know what you're talking about by a flood, because there's just a bunch of sand around here. And God said, I want you to build a boat, very specific about how he wanted him to build the boat. It was a huge boat. It took Noah 120 years to build the boat. Now, here's what's interesting. The entire 120 years, people are coming around looking at Noah and going, Noah, what you doing there? You're building a boat. Kind of crazy, Noah. There's no water around here. And Noah's preaching repentance. Come back to God. God is a merciful God, a loving God, but God's a just God. Come back to God. 120 years, Noah preaches. Nobody comes to his church. Nobody listens to what Noah is saying. We see that when the ark was finally built and there was a door on the boat that God left open for 7 days for anyone to come in. And it says at the end of the 7 days that Noah and his family went into the ark and God closed the door. Noah didn't close the door. Noah's sons didn't close the door. God closed the door. Now, what do we see in that? We see that God's patience comes to an end. For 120 years, repent, repent, repent. For 7 days, the door is open. Whoever wants to come in can be saved. And then God closed the door. That's why the story, the account of the ark is foreshadowing of what's to come in the New Testament. Because right now, for 2,000 years since the cross, preachers and people are preaching to the world, repent. God loves you. God is merciful and gracious. He will forgive you. He'll have a relationship with you. You can come in and have eternal life through Jesus Christ. And God is patient. But we know if you've read the end of the story in Revelation, there's going to come a time, just like with the boat when God closed the door, where one day God's going to look at his son and go, okay, it's time. And just like the door was closed, there were no more opportunities, the same thing's going to be true in our world. And I don't know exactly how things went on the boat, but I have to imagine that when God told Noah and his family to go in and God closed the door, and all of a sudden, for the first time in his life, Noah began to hear drops. And rain, starting off kind of slow, you know, the good kind that makes you sleep good. And then all of a sudden, more and more and more and more. And then all the people been listening to Noah for 120 years making fun of him are going, oh, that Noah wasn't so crazy. And they probably all rushed to the boat. I'm sure Noah inside the boat heard people, Noah, let us in, Noah, let us in. People banging on the door, but the door had been closed. So when we think about people that we know and love that desperately need Jesus, and we're like, well, I'll get to that someday. There's eventually going to come a time when God's patience comes to an end. But then we see the great part of the story, God, in his grace and mercy, offers salvation. I don't know how much you read the Bible, but there's an idea that I think people have, even within the church, that there's Old Testament God and New Testament God. Old Testament God is mean, and New Testament God is loving. But if you read the Bible, it's a great thing about the Bible. It's 66 books, but it's one story written over thousands of years by dozens of authors in multiple languages. And it's one story, God's redemption plan for man. And God is consistent. He was the same God in the Old Testament that he is in the New Testament. So in the midst of God saying, sighing that he had created mankind, that all of our thoughts and inclinations were evil all the time, in the midst of that, God offers grace and mercy in salvation. The very next thing we see, verse 8, Genesis chapter 6, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Like God's looking around, he's like, I'm about to wipe it all out. But Noah found grace in his eyes. Why? Because God didn't want to wipe out his creation. Did Noah get chosen because he was perfect? No. He has the same sin issue that all of us have. Noah was saved by grace. This is the first mention in the Bible that we see grace that happens. This beautiful picture of God's heart for his creation. Sin is everywhere. It's pervasive. You got demons sleeping with women. Like, it's going crazy here. And it says that God grieves, but his justice demand a punishment for sin. Noah found grace. Grace means what? Unmerited favor. Noah didn't do anything for this. Noah wasn't such a great guy that God's like, I'm going to save him. It was just grace. He found favor in the eyes of the Lord. God gave him something that he didn't deserve. Now, we're going to read later on, Genesis is an interesting book. Noah, who found grace and favor in the eyes of the Lord, and God saved him in the ark. A little bit down the road, we're going to find Noah naked in his tent, drunk. We'll talk about that in a few weeks. Wasn't a perfect guy. But God didn't save mankind because of man's goodness. God saved mankind because of God's goodness. Noah was saved by grace. Now, here's what's cool. I don't know if you've ever picked up on this. God comes to Noah, found favor, found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He says, Noah, I want you to build a big boat, which you've already established would sound crazy. You build a big boat in the middle of the desert. But look in verse 22. Noah did this. He did everything that God commanded him. I'm not gonna ask you to raise your hand, but if you live in the desert and it never rained before, and God said, I want you to build a big boat. How many of us are building a big boat? What does it take for that to happen in our lives? To listen to God in that way and do this thing that seemed crazy. What did it take for Noah to build the ark? Here's what I think we see. It took faith. Noah was saved by grace through faith. I don't know if that sounds familiar to you. Maybe you've heard that somewhere before. Noah was saved by grace through faith. And then what happens next is God makes a covenant with Noah. We pick up in the story, Genesis chapter 9 and verse 11, turn over a couple of pages. He says, I will establish my covenant with you that never again will every creature be wiped out by the floodwaters. There will never again be a flood to destroy the earth. Verse 12, and God said, this is the sign of the covenant that I'm making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all future generations. I have placed my bow in the clouds, and it will be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Now, leave this up here for just a second. How many of you think this word bow is just the Hebrew word for rainbow? Anybody? So let me give you the literal meaning when it says, I have placed my bow. The literal translation of this is, I have placed my war bow in the sky as a sign, as a symbol of the covenant between me and mankind. Now, I don't know if that makes sense to you. Verse 13, I have placed my war bow in the clouds. It's a picture, and I want to put up here, of a rainbow. You see it, you've seen it before. Beautiful. Every time it rains, storms, we see a rainbow, a partial rainbow. There's no leprechaun over here. But let me just kind of point something out. Which way is the war bow pointing? Which way? You can point. Which way is it pointing? It's pointing up. Now think about that. Let that sink in for just a second. We think about the rainbow and the covenant and the colors, and this is a symbol of God's covenant between man that he'll never destroy the earth again. But we don't think about the fact that it's a war bow. And the war bow that God put in the sky for us to see is pointing upwards towards who? Towards God. Right? This is the ultimate symbol of how God would ultimately punish sin. The war bow would be the final arrow of God's justice that would be shot, and then the bow would be hung up for good. He's symbolically showing us, hey, the final bow, the final justice for sin is going to be shot at myself. It's going to be shot at Jesus Christ. He's going to be the just payment for the sins of the world. Isn't that cool to think about? Like that war bow right there, like it's pointing up that he is who will ultimately make payment for the sins of the world. Now think about this. When does the rainbow come out? It comes out when the storm and the sunshine collide. You're like, well, there's rain clouds and there's rain, but there's also sunshine where the storm and the clouds combine. The cross ultimately was the culmination, the combination of God's wrath and mercy colliding. Again, the same symbolic symbol there that when Jesus died, he said, it is finished. That God's justice had been satisfied, that sin had been paid for forever. So how can we be saved? Same way Noah was saved. We're saved by grace through faith. That's what Ephesians tells us. Saved by grace through faith. He goes on to say, not of works, so that no man should boast. So let me just ask you this question. This is how they taught us when I was a kid, when we would share our faith. You'd ask somebody, if you were to stand before God, and he said, why should I let you into my heaven? What would your response be? If your response is, well, I'm a religious person. I'm a good person. I do good things. I'm a pretty good person. I pray. I read my Bible. I'm better than most people. That's not the biblical answer. The only thing that we have when we stand before God at that day of judgment, why should I let you into my heaven? I've been saved by grace through faith in your son, Jesus Christ. That's the only correct answer. So if I asked you that question this morning and said, do you know without a shadow of doubt, if you were to die today, that you'd spend eternity with God in heaven? If your answer is, I'm not sure, we've just seen the answer. How are we saved? By grace through faith. See, the story of Noah, even though there's a flood, and even though there's destruction, it's also a picture of God's love and God's justice and God's goodness, that God was grieved by our sin, but he poured out his grace. And just like Noah, we too this morning can be saved by grace through faith. Let me ask you to do something for me as we close. Would you just close your eyes? And I don't do this often, so if you're new or a guest, don't worry. But would you just close your eyes all around the room, and I want to ask you a few questions, and I want to pray for you. Earlier, I asked if you stood before God, and he asked you why I should let you in my heaven. What would your answer be? Would you be honest enough with me this morning? Again, nobody's looking around, just me. Would you be honest enough with me this morning to answer the question, are you 100% sure that when you die, you'd spend eternity with God in heaven? If you're not sure that would be the case, would you just lift up your hand real quick for me? Thank you, thank you, thank you. Lots of hands all across the room. The Bible says that if we confess with our mouth, Jesus the Lord, believe in our heart, God raised him from the dead, we can be saved. Salvation is by grace through faith. It's a free gift from God. It's not anything you earn. It's not anything you can do to buy God's love or earn God's favor. It's what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. God is such a gracious and good and loving God that he made the gospel, even though it's profound, simple. That if we stand before a holy God admitting our sinfulness and our need for a savior, that we can be saved. And so I want to invite you, because we had a lot of hands up all over the room, into a conversation with God. And I'm going to lead you in that conversation. You don't have to say my exact words. This is between you and God. But this is how the Bible says we can be saved. We can be forgiven. We can have eternal life. We just acknowledge, dear God, you're God, and I'm not. And God, this morning, I admit my sinfulness to you. I've messed up. I've made mistakes. I've fallen short of your standard, which is perfection, because you're a holy God. God, this morning, I ask you to forgive me. I accept and I acknowledge what Jesus Christ did for me on the cross, that he died in my place, that he took payment for my sins. So God, I'm asking you to come in my life, to forgive me. God, I'm giving all of me to all of you. Now here's what's awesome. The Bible says something as simple as that conversation, if it's truly your heart, the Bible says that you've been saved. The Bible says that what we deserve, which is death, God just took from your life and put on his son, Jesus Christ. That God gave you just now his Holy Spirit to live inside of you, that you're a new creation, that he has a plan and a purpose for your life that's better than anything that we could fathom. The Bible says that at this moment, when you have that conversation with God, that God adopts you into his family as sons and daughters. Like, can you imagine that? Like, God, the creator of the universe, just brought me into his family. And the other believers in this room and all around the world, those are your brothers and sisters in Christ. And not only did God just give you eternal life, but he desires that you would have abundant life here on this earth. So God, I pray for my brothers and sisters that just said this prayer. There were hands up all over the room earlier. God, I pray that these moments have been moments of salvation, that they've been saved, that this is the beginning of a new life in Jesus Christ. And God, I pray for those in this room that we know that we're saved. We know that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins, that's not an issue. Sometimes we can get so busy with life that we forget about that you're still a just God and that our sinfulness breaks your heart. That you desire something better for us, God. You call us to live holy. So I pray for the believers in the room. I pray this for myself, God, that I would see sin for what it is. And that, God, I would desire to be like your son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you that we see in the story of Noah, not just destruction, but we see graciousness and mercy and love. And we thank you, God, that you are all those things and you proved it through your son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Thanks for joining us today for our online worship service. God is doing so many things at Mission City Church that we would love for you to be a part of. Just go to missioncity.church to learn more. I also want to encourage you to worship today through giving. Click the Give button at the top of your screen, and you can be a part of our mission in that way as we continue to see God transform lives here in San Antonio and online. We'll see you next week.